Hi! Now, as they say, time for something completely different. Today we're going to look at an intercom that's not a NuTone. This is a radio call model. And the story behind this is I was contacted by someone who's renovating a house in Southern California, and they're trying to keep the house somewhat original. It's sort of a mid-century modern kind of place. This intercom, it was in the house, and he couldn't find any real information out about it, and he couldn't find anybody who really even wanted to talk to him about it, and then he got a hold of me. And it sounded interesting. He sent me some pictures, and I made sort of an assumption based on the pictures that it would be a doable project, and it might be interesting to do something sort of different. What is a radio call intercom? I don't really know exactly, because I can't find out a lot of information about it. According to the information that's on the unit, it was manufactured by the C&H supply company in Dallas, Texas. And here we have the C&H logo. Over here, it shows it's a model CH700-3. So I assume there were more in the 700 series than just this one. It's your basic AM radio with intercom. But it's kind of interesting. Now, when was this made? Well, it's a little hard to know exactly. There aren't any date codes or anything like that on the back of the unit. And the nearest that I can figure out is it could be 1954, 55. It's probably late 50s, could possibly be really early 60s, but I don't really know because there isn't any way to date it. And like I said, can't find a lot of information out about this. One of the things that's kind of intriguing is if it was made in Dallas, Texas, that's also where Music and Sound was originally located. So is C&H Supply Company a precursor to Music and Sound? Did fellows from the C&H Supply Company become disgruntled over something and thought, we can build better intercoms on our own, and they broke off and formed the Music and Sound Company? Possibly. I don't really know, because again, I can't really find out anything about this. So if someone watching this knows something about the history of these kind of units, you should put it in the comments down below, because that way we all can learn. So let's do a brief overview of our CH700-3. It's a metal panel. It has a really nice finish on it. It's sort of this copper tone finish. It's actually, I think, a preferable color to the NuTone units. There'll be a lot of NuTone comparisons here, of course, because those are the ones that I'm most used to dealing with and describing. It's a really nice copper sort of finish. It's painted on a steel plate. You have a single speaker here in the middle. You have an AM radio dial, the main on-off volume control switch, and then some room control switches and other things over here. Apparently, it was designed to have up to 6 remote stations. You have your intercom controls down here, and we'll talk about how this actually operates in a minute. So you have this switch here, which is you can place either in the radio position to hear the radio play, or you can flip it down to the intercom position. And then here you have a listen and talk switch, which is spring-loaded. Here you have a quarter-inch audio input jack that says phono, so it's a place you could plug a phonograph into it. And here you have a switch for the master speaker, and it's either on or off. So it's a fairly simple design, and that's where it kind of starts to fall down a little bit. It's somewhat of a clunky design, and there's lots of bits and pieces about how it works that are kind of odd, and it makes it sort of somewhat unusable, at least in my opinion. Here we have one of the inside remote stations, and I told the fella, if you're going to send me the master station, you have to send me an inside remote, and you have to send me the wall housing that goes with it, because otherwise I don't have any way to put anything together to see if it works or not. And he said, not a problem. So what do we have here? So we have a metal plate. It has this sort of textured painted finish. It looks like something right out of the military, I think. It has the same sort of round louvered area where the speaker is behind it. And there's an on-off switch, and that's all you get. Here's the on-off switch right here. On the back, you have what is approximately a 5-inch speaker cone. It's 3.2 ohms, which is pretty typical for a tube set. And you have 2 connections for the wire that comes from the master station. Oh, did I point out that this is officially a two-wire system. And two-wire systems are pretty old and pretty hard to find, and no, NuTone never made a two-wire system. All of their early systems were all three-wire systems. So basically all you have here is the speaker cone and the on-off switch and the audio from the master wires through the switch, and if you want to listen to it, you turn it on, and if you don't want to listen to it, you turn it off. There's no volume control or anything like that. There's no intercom controls. It's just a panel with a speaker and an on-off switch in line, which is kind of unusual. They could have at least put a volume control. It wouldn't have been that hard to do that, but they didn't. So at the master station, you have your six room control switches, and basically the speaker can either be on or off, and that's what you've got. You don't have any more than that, just on or off. Let's go ahead and turn it on, and we'll let it warm up for a second, because it is a vacuum tube model, and it's going to take anywhere from 30 to 45 or 50 seconds for it to warm up enough so it will play. And we'll all stand here and wait. And here it comes.
Spacewalk for Cook. I'm Mike Hempen. This report is sponsored by Shen Yun Performing Arts. Shen Yun.
Turn it down a little bit. Now, there is only one volume control, and that's the volume control for the entire system, everything all together. So it adjusts the volume at the master station speaker. It adjusts the volume to the remote speakers. It also plays into the volume for the intercom portion of the system, which is all a little bit unusual because I find it like impossible to get a decent balance. Maybe when it's installed in a house and it's all spread out, it's a little bit easier. But to get the intercom to actually work, you have to turn this volume up quite a bit. Otherwise, there's not enough gain and you can't really hear the transmission over the intercom. So it's a little clunky and kind of weird. You can raise it up and we can turn the master speaker off. And it plays through the remote station. If you want to use the intercom, you switch that switch to the intercom position, and then it's automatically in listen. So you would think if we do this, it should come out of here, but you can't hear it unless you turn it up a lot. And now you can start to hear it. And if we go like this, we can get some feedback going because they're so close to each other. And then likewise, we can push the talk switch down and it comes out over here. I don't know how you would ever adjust it so it really would function easily. The other problem with this, turn this down. The other problem with this is apparently the way it's designed, you can only use the intercom to call from the master station to the remote stations, and you can talk and listen, but you can't call from a remote to another remote or from the remote to the master station because there's no intercom buttons. So it's kind of a one-way, all or nothing kind of intercom design. It all seems rather poorly planned, perhaps, because of course, the only thing I can compare it to would be an early NuTone system from, say, 1957, which would be the model 2011 or 2012, which was a three-wire AM-only system with room-to-room intercom. However, even on that model, you had the ability to set individual volumes on each remote station. You had intercom switches on each remote station. You could talk from any room to all the other rooms. Any room could answer the front door, from the master station to any room. So it was like full communication through the house. As much as we don't want to pick on our little CH700, it just seems like it's kind of an unusual design. So let's go ahead. I'm going to turn it off and I'm going to unhook it from the wall housing. I'll show you the wall housing, and then we'll look on the back of our little CH700 and I'll show you what's back there and what I think about it. So here's the wall housing. There's no number on this. I don't know if it had a number or not. And it's kind of a typical wall housing that you would find. It's a big, fairly heavy gauge steel box. It's got a solid back on it. And up here in the top corner, you have the electrical junction. These are the wires that would wire. You bring a piece of Romex in and you wire it up. And on the bottom of the junction right here, there's a standard two-prong electrical outlet because the back of the CH700 has a two-prong plug on it. So you just plug it in. Up here, these are the antenna wires, and they plug into receptacles on the back of the set. And up here on the top of the wall housing, we have something that's kind of unusual. This is sort of a fairly standard, but not for intercoms, at least not in my experience. This is a ferrite core AM antenna. This is a lot like the type of AM antenna that you would have in a, say, kitchen or tabletop radio of the day. And, you know, if you've ever had an old radio like that, you know, if you set the radio this way, you try to listen to a certain station, it doesn't come in very clear, and then you turn the radio a little bit one way or the other, and the reception improves. That's because it has a built-in ferrite core antenna, and what you're doing is when you turn the set, you're aligning it to pick up the signal in a stronger way. Now, one of the things that's interesting about this is actually, and this type of antenna, when the set was hooked up and I was playing it, if I were to touch it, the reception would improve a whole lot because I make a really good antenna and that makes it sound better. The other thing that I did was it's held onto the top of the wall housing with this long threaded screw, and I loosened it so I can actually turn it, which is the same as turning a tabletop radio, which helped get better reception also. The other thing which you could do with this, and I don't know if this is the intention or if this is original, but this screw is quite long. Altogether, it's probably 2¼ inches long. And what you could actually do is you could loosen the nut, and I don't know if there's another nut underneath. There would have to be two nuts. You could actually raise it up on it and move the antenna away from the metal box, which would give you probably better reception. And also, in some limited way, you could probably turn it a little bit inside the wall cavity, because this would all be concealed, and you might be able to improve the reception. And then we have the remains of a lot of the original two-wire connections. Somebody cut them all off here, so I'm just going to leave that. I'm going to leave all this as it is, because this is for the fellow who's putting it back in to deal with. And here's the back of our CH700, and as you can see, there's not really that much going on here. There's not nearly as much as you would think when you were looking at the front of the unit. It's got this big, nice metal faceplate on it, and it has these punched louvers in the top and all of that, but all the top part of the unit is just basically empty. The thing really could have been much smaller in size, and all of this would have fit in here. The reason you have the louvers is they're relying on a certain amount of convection cooling in the design to help keep the chassis of the unit cool. Vacuum tubes generate heat when they're on, and the heat, of course, heats the air in the wall housing, and it can't escape through the top of the wall housing because it's a metal box, so it's going to waft out of the louvers on the front, and by the hot air rising and going out of the louvers, it's somehow going to draw cooler air in from someplace. I don't know where, because there's not a lot of holes anywhere, but that's the general idea. It's sort of a form of convection cooling. Over here, we have our connections for our remote stations, back of the switches, speaker here, and a pilot light. There is a really nice red jewel on the front that glows sort of when you turn it on and the room is dark, and that's kind of nice. Here in this close-up, you can see this would be the terminal strip where you connect one of the pairs of wires from each remote station, be wired through the switches, which are down here. So it's a two-wire system, so you have two wires for each remote station. One wire would go on under its individual screw. The other wire goes on this really jazzy little spring clip right here. And this is the kind that you push down and slip the wire through the notch and then release it and have it go back up. So here's the spring clip. You can see it's got the red dot on it for some reason. And this is exactly like the type of connections that I had on a Lionel train when I was a little kid back in the early 60s. So that helps date how old something like this could be. And what you're supposed to do, it's kind of hard to do because my finger's in the way. You push it down, you slip the wire through, and then you release it, and it sort of bites into it and holds it in place. So if you had six remote speakers, you'd have six individual wires stuffed under the clip. Not possibly the very best way to do this, but we'll get to why they probably did it that way in a second. Down here underneath the room control switches, we have our intercom switch here, our radio intercom switch next to it. This is the backside of our quarter inch audio input jack, which is a pretty standard fare for back in those days. And this is our master speaker on off toggle switch. The toggle switch on the master and on the remote speaker are both the same. They're both Leviton switches, so they are top quality, I think, for back in the day, but it's still kind of a funny design. Here's the chassis assembly. Not surprisingly at all, it's a very basic 5-tube AM radio chassis. So here's a bit of history about AM radios. Back in the day, a lot of consumer, say tabletop radios that were only AM are often referred to as American 5-tube radios because it takes a basic design which incorporates 5 vacuum tubes to build an AM radio. Vacuum tube manufacturers manufactured certain types of vacuum tubes specifically for AM radios. Because they wanted to sell a lot of those vacuum tubes, they would come up with, I don't know if they call them this in those days, but in today's world they would be called app notes. And app notes are sort of a suggested design that you could follow if you were designing an AM radio using this company's certain vacuum tubes. So since their engineers already pretty much told you how to build an AM radio using 5 vacuum tubes, we'll just go ahead and use all the work that they already did and we'll incorporate their design into our unit. So what we have here is a very basic and very common American 5-tube radio chassis. It's been modified a little bit perhaps to make it work in the CH700, but not a whole lot, just a little bit. So what we have here is we have tube number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. These are all your radio tubes. This is your power output tube. No, this is your power output tube. This is your rectifier tube. You have your variable condenser for your tuning. They did add a pilot light here, which is on this little springy bracket, and it glows through the jewel on the front of the faceplate. These are the connections for the AM antenna. You have a power transformer, an audio transformer, and your roughly 5-inch 3.2 ohm speaker cone. Of course, you have your plug that you plug into the socket inside the wall housing. What makes this all really interesting, and we'll look at the bottom of the chassis in just a second, what makes this all really interesting for me is, I think what we have here is, we have an intercom system that was designed to be built from commonly available assemblies. I think what the C&H supply company probably did was they sourced a chassis for an American 5-tube radio. Perhaps they changed it around a little bit from the way it would have come from the original manufacturer, or maybe the original manufacturer modified it for them so it could be used as an intercom also. And when you say intercom on this, you have to go air quotes like this because it's kind of an intercom. So you have an American 5-tube chassis assembly that you bought from a supplier. The speaker cone probably came from the same supplier, and then you would have had to gone to a company to buy your switches and your room switch assembly that would bolt onto the back of the faceplate. And of course you'd have to have the faceplates made and silk screened and painted and all those kind of things. But it's kind of a unit that's constructed out of individual things that you probably could source back in the day from a lot of different suppliers, and you assemble it all and you end up with a radio intercom, kind of. Anyway, so let's look at the bottom of the chassis and then we'll be done. And this is the bottom of our American 5-tube radio chassis. The chassis is just a piece of folded steel and there is a cover that goes over it. However, the cover is just a piece of cardboard with folded edges. Somebody wrote on it, so it's been worked on before. Somebody wrote some tube numbers on it, but this just goes over this like this to close it off. That's pretty interesting. So what do we have here? Well, we have your on-off volume control assembly. I think this has been replaced at some point. I don't think this is as old as the set. It looks much newer to me for some reason. Not sure, but that's kind of the way it seems. And then it's all pretty standard fare for mid or late 1950s point-to-point wiring. Now, I've worked on enough old intercoms with point-to-point wiring to tell you that the assembly quality of this unit is not really very top-notch. In fact, in some respects, it looks a lot like it could have been a kit that some amateur built at home on the weekends back in the 50s when they were all learning about electronics. It was a little interesting, but we cleaned up some of it to make it better. It has some interesting design choices. For instance, the parts that were replaced were primarily capacitors and a few resistors. These two white ones here, for instance, these are new. These are wired in parallel. You would have thought that you could have easily put in a 0.47 capacitor, but perhaps they didn't have it, so they paralleled two of half the value to add up to the total value. It's kind of interesting that you would have done that, but perhaps they ran out of the right value capacitors and they had a lot of those, so that's the way we were going to do it. For authenticity's sake, I put it back like it was. And then this white one is a filter capacitor to ground. There's a little yellow one up here. And then there are two electrolytics. There's one right here and one up here that's a little bit hard to see because it's black. These were originally in a combined capacitor where they were both inside one envelope and they were sort of stuffed in the corner of the chassis up here. So what I did to make it neat and tidy was I put a tie strip in here. I drilled out a little rivet that was holding the something in place. Oh, the bracket for the speaker, I think. I put a little threaded screw and nut and washer and put a tie strip in here and then relocated the wires that were connected to the original capacitor onto the tie strip and then tied my new capacitors into the tie strip. So everything is securely mounted. There was enough room in here to do that and it was easy to do. I put one axial capacitor up here and I put a radial capacitor down here because it actually fit in better and it was closer to the original value because some of these really old radios, the values of capacitors are unusual in today's world. So you've got to sort of hunt around and find something that's really, really close. You can usually get by with something that's reasonably close because the tolerance of things like capacitors back in the 50s, they could easily have been plus or minus 40%. And nowadays, you know, common capacitors are plus and minus 10% or 20%. So if you get something that's reasonably close, it'll work just fine. But it's a nice little chassis, cleaned it up a little bit, tightened some things down that were kind of worked loose over the years, and turned it on, and it played the first time. Well, almost. I had to clean all the switches because they were really, really dirty. And there you have it. It's sort of a look at an unusual intercom from back in the day. It's one of those mid-century modern things everybody's trying to find nowadays. It's the C&H Supply Company model CH700-3 radio call intercom system. How unusual is that? There's a lot of, this is from a house in the Los Angeles area, I believe. I've had calls from other people about unusual brands of intercom systems, and a lot of times they come from Los Angeles. So perhaps there was a lot of small intercom people running around selling weird intercoms in the 50s and early 60s in Los Angeles. I don't really know. You don't see models like this around here very much, so it must be one of those Southern California things. I hope you found this interesting, and perhaps for somebody it'll be helpful. If it is, please give it a thumbs up on YouTube, because that always helps. There'll be a banner right here that shows you how to subscribe. Go to our YouTube homepage, click on the bell, and when you click on the bell, click on it to receive all notifications. And every time we post a new video, you'll get a notification, and you can watch it. And if you know anything about this, or this brand, or have one of these, put something in the comments down below so we can learn more about it, because I'm always curious. That's all for today. See you on the next video.